Don't forget, if you're calling for from a cell phone, that you need to email LaShawn your information with your cell phone number so she can know who you are in the chat. Okay, you can have it now, Prince.
All right, thank you, Mr. Gates, for inviting me on. I do appreciate it. So my name is Daniel Prince. I'm with Equitable. Maybe you've heard of us, some of you maybe not. And I'm speaking this morning is because me and Mr. Gates got in contact a couple weeks ago, and he expressed concern that a lot of y'all may not fully understand what is offered to you for retirement working for a school district. What we do is we help employees of school districts with their retirement. That's what we do. So I shouldn't be very long, maybe 2-3 minutes. And just like Jake said, the meetings I run, they're completely voluntary, completely complimentary. So if you have any sort of questions, you can reach out with my contact information. But so Mr. Gates expressed concern that a lot of you may not fully understand what is offered to you. And I don't blame you, because as an employee of a school district, what is offered to you is different than what most people receive, right? So for those of you who have worked a previous career, maybe at a private company, you were offered Social Security as your pension plan, and you were offered what was called a 401k as your retirement plan. Working for a school district, you get neither of those, as I'm sure most of y'all have come to realize. So working for Bryan ISD, instead of Social Security, you get TRS. So TRS is now your current pension. And there's a very, very big misconception out there, and this isn't just in the transportation department, this is for all public school, school district employees. There's a very big common misconception that TRS is going to be everything that you need for retirement. And for the high majority of people, that's just not the case. So like I said, your TRS that everybody is currently contributing to, that is the mandatory pension plan. That can be thought of like Social Security. And then one thing a lot of people do not realize, this doesn't pertain to transportation department only, this is all school district employees, is you have a 401k plan offered to you. It's just not called a 401k, called a 403b. And a lot of people are not taking advantage of it. And so that is why Mr. Gates has invited me on this morning to speak to you, just to kind of let you know that you do have 401k-esque plan offered to you. So I'm helping everyone who wants to, helping educate you on your TRS and the 403b, and then helping you set up your 403b if you have not already. You know, we'll discuss how it works, if you're unfamiliar, how it coincides with your TRS. And like I said, most importantly, helping you set it up. Now, if you have worked a previous career and you have an old 401k available or an old 457 or something like that, and you would like into the 403b here in Bryan, I can help you out with that as well. So that is the main thing I do with regards to helping school district employees with retirement. I sent an email to Mr. Gates Monday afternoon. I'm not sure if he forwarded it to you all. Even if he did, I'm going to email every one of you, again, a list of all the things that I help out with, and that has my contact information on there as well. But that's pretty much it. So if you guys do have any sort of questions, you can shoot me an email, or in the email that I'm going to send out to everybody, there is going to be a link so that you can set a meeting with me at your convenience. So the link will access my calendar. You'll be able to view my calendar and you can set a meeting for whatever's most convenient for y'all. So that is it. Thank you, Mr. Gates. I do appreciate you inviting me on. But if anybody has questions, don't hesitate to reach out. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniel. I did forward the email, but if you want to send me another email to forward to them, or if you can, you want to email
them,
you can.
I will do that here in the next 10 minutes.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gates. I'm going to hop off now. I have a 9 o'clock.
All right. That's fine. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, sir.
It's really a great investment. Like when I started out doing it, I only put like $20 in it because I didn't know much about it and I was young, much younger. But as I got older, I put more and more in it. So it's a good investment, but it's not mandatory. Next, we're going to have Mr. Barlow. He's going to bring some more of that expertise training that he does. You're muted, Mr. Barlow.
All right, not anymore. Can everybody hear me okay? All right. Sounds like it. Let's see if we can make this work. As Mr. Gates said, you guys remember from last week, I'm Rick Barlow. I'm from Texas Political Subdivisions. We're the outfit that has some of the district's insurance coverage. I'm a loss control consultant. What that means is a lot of times is my providing assistance to the district in things related to risk management and safety. So today, what we're going to talk about is, let's see if we can make this work the way I want it to. I think we'll let you see this one. All right, can everybody see my screen okay? Can you all see my screen okay? Good. Good.
Yep.
All right. I'm not reading. I'm actually watching. I'm sorry. I was looking for you to raise your hands like the last time. All right. What we're going to talk about today is safe braking practices and managing speed and following distances. Let's see if we can get this working the way we need it to. All right. I tried this last week. And I'm kind of hoping to do a little bit better with it today. So when I do one of these in person, it's a lot easier for this to work. But I usually tell a little bit of story to kind of set the mood for what we're going to talk about, kind of get you in a good mood. Tell you a story today. It's about a little girl. She's talking to a teacher, and she's talking about whales. And the little girl goes, you know, says in the good book that Jonah was swallowed by a whale. The teacher kind of looks at her and says, well, you know, that's physically impossible. You know, a whale's throat is not big enough to swallow a whole human. So it's just not possible. The little girl thinks to herself, well, that's not what I read in the book. It says Jonah was swallowed by a whale. The teacher kind of getting a little upset with the student and a little irritated. She said, that a whale cannot swallow a human. It's physically impossible. A little girl at that point says, you know what? When I get to heaven, I'm going to ask Jonah. The teacher looks at her and says, what if Jonah didn't go to heaven? She said, well, you ask him. All right. That was my attempt at it this time. Was that better than last time, I hope? All right. I could say what we're going to talk about today is safe braking practices, managing speed, and following distances on the bus. This is kind of important stuff when you think about it, because what the size of the vehicle that you drive probably makes what I'm going to talk about probably more important. And a lot goes into it. So what we're going to talk about, like I said, is safe braking practices, the differences between hydraulic and air brake systems, proper seat adjustment, how that plays into it, how driving speed, perception, reaction time, and following distances have everything to do with how fast you can stop your bus And then I'll kind of provide a little summary for staying safe. We're not having this today. There we go. Can you guys hear that and see that okay? Can't hear, huh? Let me try this again. Let's try this again here. See if we can't make it a little louder. How about that? Stopping a school bus smoothly, is that better? Within the limits of safety is the sign of an experienced driver. School bus drivers must have their vehicles under control at all times. An important concept we will refer to in this training video is the relationship between the speed the bus is traveling and the weight and size of the bus. All right. Like I said, the weight, like the video actually says, the weight inside of the bus is probably one of the big things. And that's what makes, you know, good braking and good braking systems probably the most important safety feature that a school bus has. A driver that doesn't have well-inspected, well-maintained brakes has a higher risk of having an accident. A driver that doesn't understand how the system works and how it relates to how the vehicle drives probably has a harder time identifying issues to a mechanic or somebody else when something may be wrong. And a driver that doesn't follow safe braking practices and techniques is probably also at a much higher risk of an accident. And I've asked you guys this question before. School buses and drivers are rarely in the news for good reasons. You know what I mean? When you see a news story, it's not usually a good one. And when one Bryan ISD driver has an at-fault accident that makes the news, all of you in effect are kind of under the microscope, and all of you are seen in the same way. And a lot of times that's negatively. And that's not a good thing. So it's just something to think about. Your safety is important. Driving a bus is a huge responsibility. You're carrying precious cargo. So everything about it says you have to be a good and safe driver to be able to make everything work. Now it's playing with me. Let's see if we can make this go back here. Okay, there we go. We're all right. Watch a little video here on just some good stuff to know.
Stopping a school bus smoothly and within the limits of safety is the sign of an experienced driver. School bus drivers must have their vehicles under control at all times. An important concept we will refer to in this training video is the relationship between the speed the bus is traveling and the weight and size of the bus.
All right. Now, those are just some things I want you guys to think about throughout the rest of the presentation so you'll know. You have to understand the importance of applying your brakes accurately or safely is probably a better word. Stopping a school bus smoothly and within the limits of safety is a sign of a good driver and an experienced driver. And you have to have your vehicle under control at all times, because if you don't, that means somebody else is driving the bus and it's not you. Now, from what I understand, most of you guys drive vehicles that have air brakes, and this is just kind of short and sweet and to the point. usually smaller vehicles like your car, your passenger car, what probably whatever you drive has hydraulic braking system. They're smaller and simpler, and they use, you know, you have to keep the brake reservoir full of the hydraulic fluid to make sure that the fluid is there. So when the brakes are applied, they work, and they work instantaneously. The instantaneous working mechanism of the brakes usually makes for shorter stopping distances and you know, safety in the vehicle operation. Air brakes have an added delay when the pedal is applied due to the time it takes for the air to flow to the lines, and it can take up to a half a second for that to happen. When braking with air braking systems, the driver has to push the brake pedal down and hold it in place until the vehicle comes to a complete stop. I am not loud enough. All right. Now, I'm not sure if your buses have, all of the buses have anti-lock braking systems, but when you brake hard on slippery surfaces in a vehicle that doesn't have ABS, this may cause you to skid or even the vehicle to spin. ABS helps to avoid wheel lock, or helps keep the wheels from locking up and maintain control of the bus. Doesn't make you stop any faster, but it helps you maintain control of the bus when the road conditions are not good. It may be easier to steer around an obstacle than skid into one when you don't have ABS. You should brake normally when you're using ABS, and you should use basically the same force as you would use to stop a vehicle to maintain control.
Hydraulic braking systems are smaller and simpler than air brakes. When braking with hydraulic brakes, the brakes work instantaneously, but more importantly, the reduced delay and shorter stopping distances provided by hydraulic brake systems result in safe vehicle operation. Because of its immediate stopping ability, you should always be looking ahead for potential stops and be sure to apply the brakes gently. With air brakes, there is an added delay when the brake pedal is applied. This is due to the time it takes for the air to flow through the lines to the brakes, and this can take up to a half second. When braking with air brake systems, the driver should push the brake pedal down and hold it in place until the vehicle comes to a smooth stop. Also, when braking, the driver should always keep the bus in a straight line. At the same time, the driver must remain aware that it may become necessary to turn the bus if that becomes a necessity. Safely. ABS stands for anti-lock braking system. When you brake hard on slippery surfaces without ABS, your wheels may lock up. This may cause you to skid or even spin the vehicle. ABS helps to avoid wheel lockup and maintain control of the bus. We're not saying that you'll be able to stop any faster with ABS, but it should allow you to steer around an obstacle while braking and avoid skids caused by overbraking. When you drive a vehicle with ABS, you should brake normally. Use only the braking force necessary to stop and stay in control.
All right. Like the video says, you want to avoid sudden stops for the safety of your passenger and the vehicles that may be following you on the roadway. An experienced driver anticipates stops well ahead of time. They use a scanning technique that we'll talk about a little bit later. This increases the margin of safety. It means that less wear and tear will occur on your brakes. I know most of you know, if you drive a vehicle and you're constantly doing those jackrabbit starts and having to stop real fast, chances are your brakes are not going to last as long as they would if you're a more controlled driver. And that's the same is true with the bus. You have to maintain control of the bus, and man, you don't want to be throwing all the kids around in your bus, because what happens is probably, you know, when there is an incident, there is an accident report that goes with that, and other things you have to do that come into play that are probably not fun to deal with. So you're better off being in a position where you control your bus, maintain a safe speed, and do those smooth stops, so that the bus reacts the way it's supposed to. All right, we're gonna talk a little bit about bracing basics and how adjustment is important.
Here are two important points to remember. bags on a school bus. The bus driver should be comfortable in the driver's seat, and the driver should make sure that their body is adjusted to safely reach and operate the brakes. Let's join Martin as he explains the importance of proper seat adjustment.
Your seating position, I think, is the adjustment scale. You should have approximately a 90-degree angle at the hip, another 90 degrees at the knee, and your ankle should be at approximately 90 degrees as well. You should be able to rest your heel comfortably on the floor while reaching the accelerator pedal, and be able to comfortably move through the brake. How does that feel?
Feels good.
All right. Let's talk about your hand position for a moment. Should be at about 10 and 2 or 9 and 3. So you've got your hands in good position. The thumbs are out, excellent. So that if the wheel were to jerk suddenly, it would dislocate or break a thumb. Arms should be comfortably almost horizontal on the forearm. A slight bend in the elbow.
All right. Seat adjustment is very important to safely being able to drive and drive your bus in a manner that's safe for you and for your passengers. And this is just to reiterate what he just said. Body position and driver comfort is important. Even in your personal vehicle, that's important. Hips, knees, and ankles should all be at a 90-degree angle. You should be able to reach the accelerator and the brake comfortably. Your hand should be at the two positions that mentioned on the video, 10 and 2, 9 and 3. The thumb should be positioned out. And arms should almost be horizontal with a slight bend at the elbow. And always, 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 a driver should wear the seatbelt. There's no excuse for not wearing a seatbelt. And what we've learned over time is seatbelts save lives. They prevent what's known as a second collision. Usually when you hit something or something hits you, that may not be the worst part of the event. Is if you're not buckled in, whether it's in your passenger car and in a school bus, you may be ejected from the vehicle. They may find you a few feet from the accident if you're not buckled in. It keeps you inside the vehicle. It allows the strong bones of your body to take the shock instead of your delicate organs. You have a better chance of remaining conscious if you wear a seatbelt. And it keeps you behind the wheel if you swerve or you brake suddenly. Or you could be this guy. Now, that may be funny to see, but that happens more than people realize. That incident happened in Indiana a few years ago. But more recently in North Carolina, there was a similar incident where the driver wasn't wearing a bus. In that particular incident, that guy ran through some shrubbery and some bushes and actually hits the garage of somebody's house because he wasn't able to control the bus. So wearing a seatbelt is very important and can be critical. And like I said at the bottom, you think you could explain that crash to your supervisor? I don't think so. And what actually happened with this guy, he wound up retiring. It was hard to live down because every time anybody talked to him, that's what they wanted to talk about. So he wound up retiring as a bus driver. All right, let's do some review questions for up to this point. The size and weight of the bus causes the bus to take more time to brake when coming to a stop. True or false? Oh man, you guys are quick. That is very true. All right, let's try another one. Hydraulic brakes are pressurized by air, liquid, gas. None of these. Just the letter is fine. Hydraulic brakes now. Thank you, Sandra. Liquid. Hydraulic brakes are pressurized by liquid. Air brakes are pressurized by air. Seat adjustments are strictly for mirror use and have nothing to do with the brakes. You guys own that one. That is false. One more. You can bring the bus to a smooth stop by reducing the pressure on the brake pedal ever so slightly just before coming to a stop. A lot of mixed answers. That's actually true. It's a technique called feathering, and just releasing the pressure a little bit before you apply the final pressure is a way to make the bus come to a stop without any jerking motion. Theoretically. All right, we're going to talk about a little bit about rear end collision accident prevention and the act and the impact of speed and space management on driving. All right, when you talk about rear end collisions, they're often the byproduct of driving faster than conditions allow. Not having sufficient following distance from the vehicle in front of you can create a problem. And I just throw the statistic in there for your district. Bryan ISD buses have been involved in 5 at-fault rear-end collisions that have been reported to us anyway, with incurred cost of about almost $227,000, which is about 38.5% of the district total since 2016, since the policy period started in 2016. Now that's 38.5% of almost 600,000 in losses. Now I throw the last part in here just to kind of make you understand that every part of an accident is not always covered by what happens with the insurance. And I said this in the last session, it could be as much as a 1-to-1 of 4-to-1 and sometimes as high as 10-to-1 ratio on the hidden costs that are not, and I call those the uninsured costs that are not covered by the insurance policy. And that takes into account all the things that aren't covered. And that includes high premiums from having a whole lot of accidents, any deductibles that may be in play, the workers' comp part of this that may involve people getting hurt, stuff that goes beyond the limits of what the policy covers, but all kinds of things. And what that points out to me at that 4-to-1 ratio, if you have an accident that or the accidents that you've had that resulted in the almost $227,000, the hidden cost of the district is way higher. It could be as much as that amount or as much as $900,000 in hidden costs, uninsured costs that are affiliated with the loss that the district doesn't pay. Can you imagine what your district could do with another $900,000 or your department for that matter? That's raises for all of us, right? So one of the first things you realize when you drive a bus is that a school bus, depending on which bus you drive, which type of bus you drive, could be as much as 40 feet long and can weigh as much as 10 tons. That's 20,000 pounds. That's pretty heavy. Stopping a vehicle that large and heavy can pose many challenges to a driver. This is what following distance should look like.
Distances are determined by the length of the vehicle you are driving. The standard that is often used to determine the safe following distance is that for every 10 feet of length, add 1 second.
Following distance is defined as 1 second for every 10 feet of bus up to 40 miles an hour, and an additional second for every 10 miles an hour above that. This is a 40-foot bus. So up to 40 miles an hour, we'd want a minimum of a 4-second lead time. That's how close we'd want to follow the car ahead of us. Well, on the road we're on now is a 55-mile-an-hour road, so we'd add another 2 seconds.
All right, that's a glimpse of what following distance actually looked like. And like the video short there, it kind of says is determined by the length of the vehicle. Not everybody drives a full-size bus. You know, some of you may drive a handicap bus. Those buses are probably shorter and probably have the requirement for less of following distance or the scientific requirement. I don't know what your district says about what the following distance should be, but you need to add an additional second for every 10 miles per hour above the 40 miles an hour, and you should increase the following distance further during adverse weather conditions. If it's raining, if it's slippery, other conditions, if it's dark outside, if it's foggy, there are things that tell you that you need to increase that following distance to be able to achieve that smooth stop that you want to achieve. Something that you have to understand is that stopping distance is a critical element in for a driver to understand to make sure that they can avoid an accident. Understanding the major factors that determine that stopping distance for a school bus is critical. They are the perception distance, the reaction distance, and the braking distance. And there are other factors that play into it too. But those are the three concepts I want you to remember, and we'll talk about the others too. Now it's playing with me.
There are typically three things that add up to total stopping distance. These are perception distance, reaction distance, and braking distance. Add these up and you have your total stopping distance. With air brake buses, you would also need to add air brake lag distance for the 1/2 second that it could take for the air to reach the brakes. Perception distance is the distance your vehicle travels from the time your eyes see a hazard until your brain acknowledges it. With an alert driver, this is approximately 1 second. Reaction distance is the distance a vehicle travels after the hazard is recognized and until the brakes are applied. For an average driver, this will take approximately 1 second. Braking distance is the distance it takes to stop once the brakes are applied. Braking distances are set by the speed you may be traveling at, road conditions, and the weight of the vehicle.
All right. Like we were just talking about the perception distance, it's the time from the time you see the hazard till you recognize it. Except for the average person, we're talking about a second. Let's think about this. If you drive a morning route and it's early in the morning and you had something happen, say you got a baby or something and it kept you up all night, you may not be that 1 second person. It may take you longer than that to actually perceive a hazard and react to it. And if you, the same thing with the reaction distance, if you're tired or you're fatigued, you may have issues that may impact that 1 second. It may take you a little bit longer than that. The braking distance takes a vehicle to stop. That's the distance after you've actually engaged brakes. And other factors play into that too, including the lag time, that half second lag time from air brakes. So all in all, it may take you 2.5-3 seconds to perceive the hazard, react to it, and start braking. And then to bring the bus to a full stop, additional time is required for that. So it's just something to think about. And other factors that we're talking about to play into all of this is the speed you're traveling at, the type of vehicle you're driving, how heavy it is, the road surface, the weather, the conditions of your brake, the conditions of your tires, how alert you are, how fatigued you are, all of those things play into it, including what we were talking about before, which is the distance a vehicle travels after air brakes are applied, but before they're fully engaged to stop the vehicle. And for a school bus with an air brake system, which I understand is what most of you guys have, is that lag time is about 0.5 seconds. That doesn't sound like much, but you can travel a pretty good distance depending on how far you go in 0.5 seconds. So I want to put that into perspective too. Higher speeds greatly influence that stopping distance. Doubling your speed actually quadruples the distance you need to stop. At 55 miles an hour on dry pavement with good tires and brakes, it can take a heavy vehicle like a school bus approximately 170 feet to stop. That takes an additional 4.5 seconds. For vehicles equipped with air brakes, about another 32 feet is needed for that air brake lag. So let's think about that. 55 miles an hour. All right, I want to put that into perspective to give you something to look at. Say you're traveling on a freeway at 55 miles an hour, about 4 car lengths behind another vehicle. Say it's a car. As you round a curve, all the traffic is stopped about 100 yards or 300 feet ahead of the driver of the car, and the driver of the car slams on the brakes. Noticing this, you immediately do the same. Here's my question for you guys. You think you'll be able to stop in time to avoid a collision with the car in front of you, or maybe those cars stopped? What do you think? Man, hey, you guys are pretty smart. Let's put it in perspective. 55 miles an hour. That equals about, that bus is traveling at about 81.7 feet per second. All right. So if we're talking about that, it takes you, if you're in good condition that morning, you're not tired and everything's perfect with the weather, your perception time may be 81.7 feet, that 1 second. That's how far you've traveled. Your reaction time, how quickly you react to what you see to think, uh-oh, it's time to step on the brakes. Takes you another second under perfect conditions. So now you travel another 81.7 feet. All right, let's add in that 32 feet for brake lag. So we've traveled that far up to that point. All right, now we add in that braking distance and that other 4.5 seconds. So now let's think about this. Everything's perfect with the road, the vehicle, you. It's taken us about 7 seconds from when we've seen all of this to come to a complete stop. Right? So what we've done is that total stopping distance is 365 feet. Remember I said that the vehicle, the stop traffic was about 300 feet ahead of you, and the vehicle in front of you is even closer than that. So like I was saying, there's a high chance or a high probability in this scenario that the bus probably hits the vehicle in front and maybe even some of those vehicles that are stopped ahead. And that's why I say probably not, as did most of you. So that kind of puts it in perspective that I hope will help you see the importance of being able to, you know, look at what you're doing, apply the brakes like you need to, utilize the following distance like you need to. So I ask you another question with this scenario. You think the following distance was close, was good enough from that vehicle? He's about 4 car lengths behind. I would say no. I think you probably need another couple of car lengths of distance. And sometimes, depending on the weather, we do things that we shouldn't do in terms of following distance or in our haste to get where we're going. You're trying to get somewhere on time. You're behind schedule. And, you know, you kind of throw safety out the window, not intentionally sometimes, but you're trying to keep your schedule and things happen when that happens. But you want to get there and you want to get there safely. And that's why it's important that you do the things that we're talking about today in terms of the safe practices with the following distance and everything else and the safe braking and being comfortable in your seat and all of those things that contribute to a safe ride and a safe return to the bus yard for you and your bus. We talked about this before. I think back in January when I visited with you guys, we talked about the I guess one of the good things about driving is being able to scan the roadway and scan ahead, basically looking to the future. At lower speeds, you're probably looking about a block ahead. At highway speeds, you're probably talking a quarter of a mile. And you have to stay aware of the object in front of you and don't stare too long at any one particular object. And the more your speed increases, the further ahead you should focus and increase your following distance from the vehicles in front of you. And you have to always scan for pedestrians and people on motorcycles and bicycles, because most of the guys I know that drive motorcycles, they are not the safest people to be around in traffic because they don't follow the rules of the road to a whole lot. They follow what they know, which is in and out of traffic. It's important to look ahead for curves and other obstacles and hills that you can't see over. It allows for you to make safer speed adjustments. If you take a curve too fast, and that should be T-O-O, you can lose traction and skid off the road. You can even probably have a rollover depending on the road conditions. Always brake early when headed into a curve. Look ahead and anticipate the conditions that might be in front of you so you can react accordingly and bring your bus to a smooth, safe stop like you should. Driving at night and in low visibility, say it's foggy out. When driving a school bus in low light or at night, you should always be able to stop within the distance you can see ahead of you. At night, low beams let you see about 250 feet in front of you. During the day, the fog, the rain, other conditions may require that you slow down to be able to see. And never, never, never follow the taillights in a severe storm of fog. Follow the taillights of the vehicle in front of you because you have no idea whether that person is on the road or in the right place or not. You got to maintain a good following distance, slow down, and make sure you travel at a speed that's safe for the bus, you and the bus. And you want to increase, the following distance in those situations so you'll be able to stop smoothly and safely if you have to. You can't steer a bus unless you have traction. Traction is the friction between the tires and the road. And it'll take longer to stop and be harder to stop for that matter when the road is slippery. You have to drive slower to be able to stop in the same distance as you would on a dry road. When the road conditions or weather conditions deteriorate or when your speed increases, then your following distance should increase too to help keep you safe. Remember, like I said, you're carrying precious cargo. So in talking about what we talked about today, what I want you guys to remember, you need to take the time, if you're a first-time driver especially, take time to understand how your brake system works. When you take your bus out, kind of practice hitting your brakes so you'll know what it feels like under no traffic conditions in a way where you can make sure you understand when something may be out of sync, out of alignment. Want to be sure that your seat is properly adjusted to allow for comfortable reach of your vehicle's control. You want to practice braking your bus at various speeds to improve your ability to make smooth stops so you don't throw all your passengers around. You'll maintain an adequate following distance from the vehicles in front of you to make sure you don't meet the person in the back seat of the vehicle in front of you. You want to scan your driving environment and use your mirrors in a safe and productive way so you can keep that space cushion that you need to stay safe. You want to look ahead for curves and other road hazards and brake early. I was doing a training session at another district, and we were talking about looking ahead for curves, and I told them about a circumstance one time where a bus driver sees this big bag in the road and was trying to decide, and there's a narrow road, and he was trying to decide whether to go around it or over it. Well, the driver happened to stop and get out and look, and it happened to be puppies in the bag, which is kind of scary. Somebody put the puppies out there and was hoping they got ran over. So in talking to the transportation director of that particular district, she said, well, I tell my guys, you know, they don't need to slow down for anything. My guys would just run over that bag. And I thought, oh, how cruel. So we were talking about another scenario where I've seen a situation where there's a road obstruction. It looked like a bag of material, and it was actually a motor. And a driver ran over and tore up the bottom of the bus. So it's a double, every situation is kind of a double-edged sword in terms of how you address it. But you're charged with making that decision. And all I can say is hopefully you'll make a decision should that happen to one of you and you have a scenario where you need to assess what you need to do for some hazard in the road. You want to decrease your speed and increase the following distance when the conditions dictate, whether that's road, weather, traffic, night, fog, whatever it is, you want to decrease your speed and increase your following distance. Okay, that's the end of my presentation, except for these review questions. I'm going to see where you guys are in terms of just paying attention to my spiel. So first question. Stopping distance is determined by, just a letter is fine. I'm just with too many smart people today. The answer is D. You are correct. You can use a counting technique to maintain adequate following distances. True or false? I'm scared of you guys. Answer is true. At night, low beams let you see about 50 feet ahead. True or false? Uh-oh. This is one of those gotcha questions. Looks like I got you to both of you guys, a bunch of you guys. Answer is false. What did I say? How far? 250 feet on low beams. One more. Excuse me. When you apply, when you brake hard on slippery surfaces, you may skid or even spin the vehicle, or even roll over, for that matter. All right, you guys look like you're back on track. Answer is true. And that's the end of my presentation. Guys, I have truly enjoyed it, as I did last week. You guys are real quick with the answers. I wish I could type that T as fast as some of you guys do. I use the hunt and peck type method. Sometimes it takes me a while to find the T and the F. But I appreciate you guys listening to me. If you have any questions, here's a chance to ask them. Give you a couple of seconds for any questions you may have. Hopefully the session was informative and you got something out of it. I figure a lot of the stuff that we talk about, if you're an experienced driver, you've probably heard it before. Maybe we fill some of the gaps for some things you may have forgotten about. But hopefully it provides you with information that will help you in your journey for being the great drivers that I know you all are. Thank you. Mr. Gates, I turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Rick. It was great. I appreciate everything you did this week and last week. It was very informative for all of us. I appreciate you.
All right.
So no one has any questions for Mr. Rick? I don't see any questions so far.
I can actually see it this time. All right. Mr. Gates talked me into doing the second monitor, so I can actually see you guys.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rick. We appreciate you.
All right, I'll talk to you the next day.